So hello all, can you hear me? Okay. So I think we should wait. There are only 84 right now. So all those who are present here, the Dropbox is installed or yes, no, some issues have popped up. So I assume it's yes. So those who are using VirtualBox in Windows, they can obviously use VirtualBox and install VS Code inside that. But you can also just use directly your Windows system. Even that is fine actually. So let us just wait 5 minutes more. This is function Okay, class, the screen is visible. Thank you. So 182. Okay, so we start. So remaining of the CS 102 lectures will be taken by me. So a short introduction for myself. I am Dr. Mayank Agarwal, belonging to the Department of CSE. I joined this institute in July 2018. Right, my PhD was in Wi-Fi security from IIT Guwahati. I stayed there for 6.5 years, and then I did my postdoctoral research from Israel. That was on malware security. So primarily my interest is network security, but these days with the advent of machine learning and all, so I'm also trying to learn those concepts. So my style of teaching would be a bit different because I want that as the lecture goes on, you try to learn by doing, right? So in times of pandemic, we at least have this opportunity that we can try to learn by actually writing the codes. Fine. So today's chapter will be on functions. I believe array has been completed for you all. So today we will look at functions, right? So I'm not sure how many of you have configured VS Code. I assume most of you have configured VS Code and the codes are executing. Yes or no? So you configured VS Code with GCC and all the extensions. Similarly, that I just showed prettier code runner and C++. Okay, so I assume it to be yes. Okay, so why do we require functions in C and what is the objective of it, right? So you have already done few labs in C. So right now you must be writing everything in int main, right? So what is a function and why it is required? So first we will see a program execution and then we will try to understand how do functions help us, right? So this is again a very simple code. In this, basically what I am trying to do, I am trying to compute the square of a number. So I am taking two float variables, which are input square, input number and a square, right? I am asking the user for entering a number. I just scanf that particular number. I write float square and I then compute the square of a number, which is nothing but the number multiplied by itself. Yes. Actually, I'm recording it using a third party tool and then probably I will upload it on YouTube also. Let me just push the record button on WebEx also. Start recording. I'm not sure whether other faculties do on cloud or on my computer. Okay, let me do on my computer. सिस्को वेबेक्स. ओके, सो फॉर दोज हु हैव कॉन्फिगर्ड वीएस कोड एज वेल एज ड्रॉपबॉक्स, सो आर यू एबल टू सी द शेयर्ड फोल्डर्स इन ड्रॉपबॉक्स? सो यू शुड बी एबल टू सी समथिंग लाइक ऑफ दिस सॉर्ट इन ड्रॉपबॉक्स. आर सम एबल टू सी यस और नो? Okay, cool. That's really great. So what you can do is, you just start your VS Code, right? So when you start your VS Code, since these lectures were already open, so you just can do File and just click on Open Folder. Once you select your Open Folder, come to your Dropbox, right? So Dropbox automatically makes an icon here. So come to your Dropbox, you will actually see a CS102 folder. Once you see that folder, today we are on lecture 12. Just click that lecture 12 and select folder. So you will see all the files actually, you can see on the left pane here. Function 1, function 2, function 3 and all. And you can also execute the code while I am executing, right? And for those who have not yet configured, you can just see the video and configure it, right? It will be easy only. So of course, this is a very simple program to compute the square of a number. So just let me right click in the blank space and click run code. So when I run the code, oh, some error. Redeclaration of square. Let me just see what has happened. Okay, I redeclared it here. Sorry. There should be only one declaration. Okay, so it is asking me enter some number for finding square. Let me enter, let's say 12. We know the answer is 144. The square of the given number 12 is 144, right? A very simple program. Now we will see how can you define the same program using functions and why do we require functions. So now as you see that, okay, for computing the square of a number, technically the code is only just a one-line code, right? Just multiplication of itself. But let's say you all have your scientific calculator, 991ES, that has more than 500 functions in it. Right, more than 500. Now, let's say if I ask you to design a C program that can compute all the 500 functions, and if you start writing everything in main, your code will get a huge one, right? Assume that every function, right, every mathematical function is 5 lines. 500 functions will take about 2500 lines of code, making the code cumbersome. So now, just let's see how can we convert a code. Which is, see, this has only one function, right? Every C program will have at least one function, at least, which is the main function. And how do you define a function or how do you identify a function? So any word written by a followed by a round parenthesis. So you can see these are round parentheses. So that means it's a function. Now you can see that printf. Printf is also a function, right? You can see the round parentheses are there. So printf is also a function. Even scanf is also a function. Some textbooks refer to functions as modules also. So both are the same thing. Whether you call it function or you call it modules, they are the same thing. So now just see this code. Now you can come basically to function underscore 2.c, right? This is the same code, but I am basically using a function now. Now, how do I define a function? So let us start from the start. So we have the include, just forget it. For time being, forget line number 4 as if it is not there. I will explain you why line number 4 is actually useful. So we have the same thing, float input number, and I'm defining a variable called squared value. Fine. So now what I'm doing, I'm asking the user to enter a number for finding square, same as the previous one, and I'm doing the scanf. So you can see these two lines are exactly same as this code. Now you can see, instead of writing the input into input, I'm defining a function called square. This can be anything, right? This can be even your name also. So if you want, let me just try to make this as, okay, CS102. Okay, so I will have to do manually because there are some missing this. Right, so I am writing square underscore 102 because the course name is 102. So now what will happen? The code will start here, enter some number for finding square. You enter a number, let's say 12. Now this compiler sees that, okay, I'm calling a function. Now how do you see that this is a function? Because this is followed by a round parenthesis. Anything which is followed by a round parenthesis, that means it's a function. Now there are some inbuilt functions, like main is an inbuilt function. C already know what is the meaning of main. C already knows what is the meaning of printf. And C already know what is the meaning of scanf. Now, when you define your own function, let's say square underscore 102. Now, C does not know what is square underscore 102. It's like when you start learning a language, it's like a word which is unknown to you. So you do not know the meaning, so you cannot use it in a sentence. So the moment I write square underscore 102, and what I'm passing, I am passing the number which I have taken input from the user. Right, so let me just execute the code. First, you can just see whether the code is working correct or not. Okay, let me clear the screen. For clearing the screen in Windows, it is CLS. And if you are a Mac user or a Linux user, you can just write clear as it is. Right, clear works in Windows also. So just let me right click the code and execute this. So I am asking it to take the square of a number 12. And you can see that the square of the number 12 is given as 144, which means it's a correct answer. Now, how did this code execute, right? So this code executes like this. Enter some number, which is coming here. Scanf, I entered 12. Now I'm calling a function square. So what happens here in this particular case is, the moment I basically come on this square part, the control. So let me just show you on a piece of paper and then you will understand how it. Okay. Okay, guys, I hope the CS102 is visible, right? So let me just rearrange the windows for your convenience, and I am just hiding the menu. Okay. So what happens? You have a, okay, we have an int main here, right? No issues. We have an int main, right? I am defining something, and then I have a line which says square value. Squared value is equal to square underscore 102, and then I'm taking input number, NUMBER, right? And then I have few lines, and then I'm defining float. Floatex. And here I am computing the square. Basically, I am writing here, if you see the code, p is equal to x into x. And then I use a word called return p. Right? So let me change my pen color. Pen color is this. Okay, let me take it red. So now what happens? Always the execution will begin with main, always, right? So if you have like 1 million functions in your code, the compiler will first search for the keyword main, wherever it is, whether it is on line number 1 or line number 10 or line number 20,000. Compiler will search for the main first, right? So it starts with main, it goes step by step, right? So start here. Then it goes sequentially. Sequentially means one below the other, it comes here. Now what happens? The moment it encounters, right? The moment it encounters this function, right? Why it's a function? Because you can see you have a round parenthesis here, right? So the control of the command. See, after the square, we have two more lines, right? Like printf and, sorry, we have one more line, which is printf. So that won't be execute. The program control will basically directly jump to this particular point. What does the compiler do? Compiler now does not know what is the meaning of square underscore 102. Now it will start searching for the whole code. Where is square underscore 102 exist? Whether it exists or does not exist. Right now we are assuming that it exists. So it will come to this particular function. So the square jumps to this particular value. It computes a square x into x, and then you can see there is a statement called return, right? So what does return say? Return says that go to the point where you started, right? Go to the point where you started. So what happens? Let me just change the pen color. Pen color is, let's say, blue. Hide menu. So the moment the return value comes, the control again jumps to this particular statement, and basically when you do a return, the semicolon is executed. Basically, if you it's not visible here, but the semicolon will be executed and then the remaining lines will be executed. So if I show in terms of number, you start with main, that is step number one, then you execute everything, then you go to the function, which is step number two, then you jump to the function, which is step number three, then you return something or the function ends, which is step number four. You go back to the point where you came, where you called from, which is step number five. And this is step number six. And finally, the program exits. So this is the way the functions are being called, right? So it's a new concept. So understanding it is easy actually, but I just wanted to show you how in actual the function execution takes place, right? So let us again come to the code. So we took an input number. Let us again just clear the screen, right? So enter some number. So basically I am on this particular statement. I am entering 12. So scanf will be executed. So now what happens? I am calling a square function with the value 12, right? Because the input number was 12. So here basically I am storing 12. Right. By the time I'm teaching, you can execute on your machine also. And then the control will basically jump from this line to this particular line. So now you may ask, sir, here square is written, here input number is written, and why I'm writing here x? I should have written input number, right? So that actually does not matter. You can keep both the things. So let me show you, even if I keep input number here, the answer will be the same. So even if I keep input number here, so let me run the code. Let me do it for 15. So you can see it is 225, right? So just let me clear the screen. Oh, sorry. And let me keep it back to x. Now I will tell you why I'm keeping it x. So what happens when you call a function? So this input value is actually copied to the variable x. This input value, so the input value, let's say the last time was 15. So when you execute the code, this 15 is copied to this variable x. So since it is copied to the variable x, whether you keep it x, whether you keep it CS102 or rainbow or input number, does not matter. So as everybody know, input number is a float, right? So let's say the float occupies 8 bytes in the memory. So since it is copying, this variable x will also occupy 8 bytes in the memory. It's like a Xerox, right? We do a photocopy, it's like a Xerox. So now whatever operations will be done on x. So for what? Now what we are doing with x, we are defining a new variable float p. The value of p basically is x into x, which is nothing but a square, right? And then we are doing return of p. Return p means ki now my work is over. Return to the point where you called, right? So from where it was called from line number 13. So basically when you return something, right? So when I entered 15 here, so let me run the code. Let us say I entered 15 here. So 15 into 15 became 225. So the value and variable P was 225. So when I'm writing return P, basically this is like return 225, right? So when I return 225, where it will return? It will return to the point where it was called. It was called on line number 13. Now you can see I'm writing a variable squared value is equal to this function, right? So this function, after calculating everything, returned me 225, right? So what happens internally in the compiler, this statement will become like this. Squared value is equal to 225. Because the function returned me 225. If I had entered 12, the 12 square is 144. technically it will be like this because we are defining a floating variable here. So the return value basically replaces the function call internally, right? So this is done. And then finally, we just print this squared value. So any doubts or issues till now? Right? Now you may ask, ki, why did we define this here, right? So a function has various parts. So let me, you can just open this image. I have given this image. And this is from the Geeks for Geeks. So credits to them. So you can see there is something called as function prototype. You can assume prototype like a skeleton, right? See how the function look like. Okay. So you can see the first thing here, it is written as int, which is known as return type, followed by a heading, which is known as a function name. And then we have parameters, which are also called as arguments. Okay. So let me just keep this on the left hand side and I will keep this on the right hand side. So now let us compare word by word, right? So if I see this header and body, see here he has written int, right? The return type is int. In my case, the return type is float. So return type can be int, character, float, and there is also a special return type which is called void, which we will see later, right? Then we have a heading. Heading is nothing but a function name. So function name in this particular case was square underscore 102. So function name can be anything. It can be even your name, right? So let us change the function name. So what I'm doing, I am replacing square underscore 2 with, let's say, some weird name. Let's say Casio, right? The code will still work. When I say 10, it becomes 100, right? So function name can be anything, but remember one thing. The function name cannot clash with the inbuilt function name, right? So I cannot make this Casio as something called as printf, right? So this is not allowed because printf is already defined by C, right? So now if you execute this code, you will see there will be an error, right? Int, printf, constant and everything. So it will throw up many, many errors. Why? Because this is an inbuilt function which was defined. Then there are something called as parameters or arguments. Again, different textbooks will have different terminologies. Some will use arguments, some will use parameters. Both are same, can be used interchangeably. Fine. So in this case, here the author has written void. It can be any parameter also. For example, in this particular case, I am writing float x. That means x is my parameter. So you can have 1, 2, 3, as many parameters as you want, as you desire. You will just see few examples so that the concept gets clear in your mind, right? And then this is the body, right? So in the end, it is writing return 0. So this is basically the body of a function. So few things. So this is called the prototype. As you can see, there is no semicolon in prototype, right? So you can see there is no semicolon here. As against every C statement has a semicolon in the end, but this does not have a semicolon. Just like if you do a for loop, right? So let's say you write a for loop and give a semicolon here, right? So that means everything within the braces will have no meaning at all, right? Same thing happens for this. If you write this function header and give a semicolon here, it will basically mean it's a function like this, as equivalent to like this, right? So don't worry about this. So just remember one thing, when you define a function, see you are calling the function here, and in this case, basically you write square underscore 102 or whatever is a function name, and you don't give a semicolon because you are already defining the body, just like for and while loops, right? So I hope this point is clear. Finally, there is one thing which is called function declaration, right? So function declaration, why it is required, I will tell you the two cases, right? So if you can see how to write a function declaration, you just copy this particular line, paste here and give a semicolon. Now you may ask, sir, yeah, there is no semicolon here, but why we have to give the semicolon here? Good question. In this case, when you are defining the function body, right? Whenever you are defining the function body, you did not give a semicolon. But here, what you are doing, you are basically saying the compiler that something of square underscore 102 will come in the body. So just don't throw up errors. So I will explain you once again. Let me just comment out this part. See, now I'm commenting out this part. Okay, so let me clear the screen and make this full screen. See, now I have commented this particular part and I'm executing the code. It should pop up an error. Right. So what is the error? Implicit declaration of function square underscore 102. Right. So it gave too many errors. Basically, the compiler is saying that in my compiler, square underscore 102 is not defined. I know what is the meaning of printf. I know what is the meaning of scanf, but I do not know what is the meaning of square underscore 102. So now there are two ways how to overcome it. One way is you directly define the function above the main. See, I just cut this part and above the main I am defining it. Fine. Now the code will execute, right? See, enter some number. I'm entering 15. Let me just clear the screen and re-execute. Enter some number. Let's say I'm entering 16. Square of 16 is 256. Now, why did not it give an error? Because as I said, the code basically starts from the top, and now when the compiler was reading the whole file line by line, it actually encountered the whole definition of the function. So it actually came to know that, okay, square underscore 102, it basically saw at line number 7, right? Now when it goes from top to bottom and comes to main, it says square underscore 102, right, which is in line number 21. Now the compiler remembers, yes, I saw something of square underscore 102 on line number 7, right? So I will now not throw an error. I know what does it mean. It's a user-defined function and not my own function. So one way, if you want to avoid writing this line, you declare all the functions above the main, or if you want to declare the function below the main, right? So you have to then specify this. This single line says the compiler that don't throw an error if you encounter square underscore 102 in the main. I am defining it after the main, right? Hope this point is clear. If you have any queries or doubts, you can ask. Achha. Okay, I just do a simple search and replay. So you can use Control R, sorry, Control H, H as in hen. So basically, you can see this menu has come up. So this is search and replace. In basically here you have another good option in VS Code. You just select the variable name. But frankly, in some usages, I have encountered some bugs in VS Code. So on right click, you can see rename symbol is there. Right, you can do a rename symbol, and now let us say we can write it rainbow, right? And you can just press enter, so you can see everything gets renamed, right? But be very careful while using this option, because let's say you define something of a variable called n, right? Let's say if I define integer n, fine, and now I'm saying it to go okay, here, rename n to something, let's say apple, right? So at times, see, it is showing some errors because it is trying to convert slash n and other things also. So just be very careful by using this. Ideally, you should use this rename variable because Microsoft, and this is basically called as refactoring. If you are using IDE, this technique is called as refactoring, right? So now all those who have con yes. Yeah, renaming is better in most of the cases. Renaming is actually better because, let's say what happens. So let's say if you are defining squared value and squared value underscore, let's say 1, fine. Something of this sort you are defining. So now if you rename this, so let's say you rename squared value to, let's say, cube, right? So what will happen? See, this has also changed now, cube underscore underscore 1. Right, so it may impact your program execution, but in case when you just right click here and do a rename symbol and do a cube here, it will basically do an exact match. See, this remains the same, right? So this is done, and yes. See, for the main, because main is a function which is defined by the compiler itself, it implicitly assumes that if you don't give a return statement, the main will automatically return zero. Basically, you can return anything, any integer value. Basically, you can also do a return 6. But you asked a good question. It is always better to explicitly write, right? Because some old compilers may give an error. So always a good practice to write a return statement. So for all those whose VS Code is configured and everything is working well, now let us try to write a function which computes the cube of a number, right? So let me just do a control Z here. Right? Let us try to write a cube of a number. See, VS Code is open for all of you. The simplest way is, because see, nothing will change in a cubic function except for the case of multiplication. So I am showing you the simplest way and how functions are working, right? And what is the advantage? See, we already know that our square function is working pretty well. So do one thing. Just copy this entire block, Control C, Control V. Now, two functions cannot have the same name, which is very implicit, just like two variable names cannot be the same. So now let us keep something of a good name, right? I am keeping this function as cube. Now, what will happen in this cube is, I just need to have multiplication of 3, right? So this is my function body, right? Function declaration plus function body, right? And in the main, what will I do? I will write here a variable called, let's say, cube value, okay? For finding square and cube. So for the same number, let us find a square and find a cube. So I am taking the input number, fine. Now let us do one thing. I will again copy this particular line. I know that my now value is a cube value. And what is the name of the function? The name of the function is cube. So I will make this as a cube function, right? And then I have printed a square value. Let me just copy paste this and just let me write cube of the given number is, and this will be cube value. Right? So still one thing is remaining. As I told, either if I can keep this before the main, then I need not write a line like this, or if I want to keep it after the main, let me see. So what I will do, I will just copy this line. This method is very easy. See, just copy the entire line, paste it anywhere, and give a semicolon. Right? So now let us check once again. We have a cube float, which is taking one parameter x. I am passing it one parameter and it is computing the cube of this. Right? Now you may again say ki, okay, we are defining different function names, but we are keeping x as same. That does not matter because I will explain you that in when we deal with scopes, probably tomorrow, or I will just explain you the idea. So let me just run the code now. So let me just write 5. So you can see square of the given number 5 is 25 and cube of the given number 5 is 125. Let me just clear the screen and execute once again. So let me enter 8. Square of 8 is 64 and cube of the given number 8 is 512. So now I hope you will be getting the importance that why functions are needed, right? So once a function is ready, you know that, okay, this particular block is working well. So your debugging time is saved. Let's say now you are writing a matrix multiplication code. So now you already know that my cube and square are correctly defined. So I need not search for any bugs in these codes. I only need to find a bug in matrix multiplication code, right? So let us just let me give this a good name. Square function. Square underscore fun. Okay. So this was with relating to function, and now let us see a function basically can call another function. Now what does that mean? Okay, so let me just show you. Let me just show the program execution for this. So now you can see we had two functions in this particular case, right? So let me just arrange this and Let me just shift this to right hand side. Okay, show menu. Next, yeah, add and hide menu. Okay, so in this case, we had this execution. We had void, sorry, void main, no, we had int main, and then we had defined squared value is equal to square of function, and then we had input number. Similarly, we had cube underscore value is equal to, we had a cube value and we had an input number. And then here we define float square fun. We had something of float x, few lines of code, and then we had float cube. Let us just check cube. Float x and few lines. Right. So let me just change the pen color to red, and then we will see how the execution takes place. Right. So as always, the program will first come to main. Right. Then it sees a function, this one, and it will see that, okay, this is a function here. So after two, it defines a function three. I mean, it calls the own function, it executes, let me write it 4, and then when the function exits, it goes back to the point where it was called. Where was it called? It was called here, and then it terminates. So 5, basically you can see that when the function exits, it executes the semicolon here. After 5, we come across 6, which is the cubic value. The cube basically is a function. Why function? Because we have round parenthesis. And from 6, we basically jump to the cube function, which is then we have the whole body executing. We exit here, right? And then we come to the semicolon here, which is 9. And then the remaining part of the main is executed, which is 10, right? So this is how the execution order basically takes place, right? So there is something called as a stack data structure. Stack, you must have read till now, ki, okay, in general English, stack basically is like a stack of books or a stack of plates, right? So you all miss the wonderful mess food because of pandemic. So in mess, there is a stack of plates which are arranged. Or whenever you go to a marriage, you have a set of plates arranged one above the other. Fine. So what happens? Okay, this is plate 1, this is plate 2, this is plate 3. So let's say one guy is coming to eat the food. They actually pick the plate on the top. They don't lift all the plates and then go for plate 1, right? They just pick that plate on the top. Then the next guy will come, he or she picks plate number 2, and so on. So basically, stack data structure, what happens? So let's say I'm drawing something like this. In this, insertion takes like A, B, C, D, like this, right? So first was A, then second was B, third was D, and fourth was, sorry, third was C and fourth was D. But when you remove, basically first D will be removed, then C, then B, and then A. Why I'm explaining you this is because when you use functions, internally a stack data structure is used, which you will see later. But let me just point you out what happens like this. You can just see a representation, right? First, you start with the main, right? So once you come to the main, you basically see that a square function is called, right? So on top of main, because see, when the square function is called, let's say when the square function is called here, the remaining part of main is suspended temporarily, right? Suspended temporarily means, for example, if this function never ends, if I write an infinite for loop, basically the program will never come to this particular point, right? So from the main, I am calling the function square. So what I will write here, from the main, I am calling the function square. Okay, so now we have, first we called up main, second we called up square. So what will happen? It will come to square, execute everything, and then exit. When everything exits, what will happen? So square function executed and exited. So this entry will be erased. Why? Because at this particular point, the function exited. Now what happens? Now where will be my cursor? It will be back to main, right? So basically I come back to main. Now what happens? Now I am seeing another function which is known as cube. So what will happen here? We will again make a stack like this. Basically it happens on this stack only. We will have something like a cube function. So once the cube exits, this cube again will go from here, right? So a little tricky concept in the start, but once you write starting your program, you can just forget stack for right now. When we will see recursion, we will go into more depths of it. A few things that you need to keep in mind is, like, for example, let us define a new function which is known as addition, right? So let's say we will add something. Okay, let me start here. Now let me do something known as void. Void and x, right? So given any value, okay, let's say I am just writing the function name as add2. So whatever input value is given to me, I will add that value, and then that's it. So now let us define another function. So we are taking the input as input number. Now keep in mind, I am writing something as void. Void means the function will not return anything. So see, in this case, I was returning something of the type of float, right? So return p, this value means you are returning something of the type of float. So you can see that p was defined with a floating point value. So if you do something kind of a mismanagement, so for example, if you write int here, but you are returning a float here, it may result in an erroneous answer, right? The program will compile successfully or may give a warning, but may result in an erroneous input, right? So now let us write a function here, add2. And since it's a void function, what will I do? I will just do right. Now you can see wherever you are having a return type, right? Return type means I am, this function will return, cube will return a float value, square will return a float value. So whenever a function is returning something, you need to ensure that there is a variable on the left hand side. Why? Because it's like the function is throwing a value at you. Like, let's say when you play a volleyball, it's like when you throw a ball at somebody, right? So when the function throws you a value, there should be someone to catch that value. And what is that someone? That someone is a variable name. That's it. But that is not the case when you do something with a void. Void, basically, if you see the English meaning, void means empty, right? Empty means nothing. So here I'm defining a value, defining a function add2, right? And I'm calling the function. You can see there is no variable name here, right? No variable. Right, remember this thing, no variable is defined on the left hand side. Now I'm taking an input number, right? So what can I do? Let me just write the function line by line. So what I can do, I can just copy this line and remove the semicolon, because I will define the body here itself. So you are taking an input number. This input number will be copied to the variable x, right? So let me define here. I can directly actually write printf here. The number after adding 2 to it is, so let's say percent f comma, then we have x plus 2, and then we have a semicolon here. I can actually define a variable name like sum and then add 2 and display that value. That is also fine, right? So now let me execute the code. Hopefully there are no errors. Okay. See, the number after adding 2 to it is 7, square of the given number is 25, and cube of this. So I don't understand why this function executed first. Let me just check it out. The square function should have been executed first, followed by cube, and then this add function. Let me just check. Probably some bug of VS code. right? The functions are called in the order of calling, right? Acha. Okay, sorry. Yeah, that is the reason. The printf is later, right? Because we are printing for the square and this value. Okay, so for the square, that is absolutely correct, right? So there was no bug. Basically, when we call the square function, you come to the square function, you just compute the value but don't print anything, and that is stored in the squared value. Similarly for cube, but for add function, immediately we are actually printing the value of add, right? What is the value of add? So this is how basically functions work. And now the good thing about functions is you can call a function from another function, right? So let's say you are defining an add function here. So let me just try it out. Let me just call the add function from here. And now I have to give this x. Let me just try this out. Add 2. This will be here. So now you can see from the square function, I am calling the add function. Let me just check the output, clear the screen. So let me enter 6. Right. So basically what happens, again, the program executes. Now I will tell you how the function basically goes about the computation. Okay, let me just take another blank sheet. Show menu, we have next and add and hide menu. Right. So now in this case, what happened? We had a main function. Okay. Pen color is black. So we had a main function. We had some things here and we defined the square fun. And we are passing. I am writing in short form, input number. And then we had a cube function. Right, and then we had a function called add2 taking input as float x. Okay, but there is still some noise. Guys, there are someone, there is, the mic is on. Ritik Singh, I think, you know, it's mute only. So we have add 2 and yeah, the student can kindly turn off their mics and keep it on mute. Okay, so now let us see how the execution proceeds. Pen color is red. Hide. Yeah, class, kindly mute yourself because there is too much of background noise which is coming. The list is so long to scroll, mute all. I don't know why this... mute all does not work here, because from my end definitely there is no such background noise. I am even not turning off the on the fan. Guys, there is someone who has a mic turned on. Kindly please turn off your mic. Yeah, can someone WhatsApp him or her? I mean, who is the guy whose mic is on? Okay, nevertheless, I just show you the main. So main is always one. Then we have two. So now let me just show you how does it work. So first you start with main. While main is going on, you call the square function. Square function. And now within the square function, you are basically calling the addTo function. You can see here you are calling the addTo function. So now my stack will be up to 3 units. Now what happens, once you complete the addTo function, once you are done with the addTo function, the basically, see here there is no return statement, right? There is no return statement because there is a void here. So what happens when the function gets over, right? The complete execution is over, it will return to the point where it was called, where it was called. Now where it was called in the square function, right? So what happens here? So from 2, it will go to 3 here. From 3, it goes to 4 here. From 4, it goes to 5 here. It will execute everything. It will come to the exit statement. And from here, it will go back to here. It will not go back to main. It goes back to here because addTo function was called from the square function. So it returns, or it basically goes back to the point from where it was called. It comes here. This function exits. Now square function exists. Where does it call? Where from where it was called? It was called from here. So 9 comes here. Then 10 is here. 11 goes to the cube function. This exits, and then we come to 12, which is nothing but main. So this is how the function basically computes. So when add is, when the add function over, this goes from here to the square function. When square is over, square goes main to the main function. Now main again calls the cube function, which is here. When cube gets over, it again comes back to the main. And when the main exits, right, the main has this point of exiting, the main is also destroyed, right? So this is how the function goes about. So the guy whose mic is on, I think, yes. Yeah, the mic is still on. Can somebody WhatsApp or call that guy and ask to mute the mic? Okay, so you wanted to ask regarding? Okay, in general, let me just try to explain you the call of the function. Right. So let me just give you a very brief idea, right? So this is not a code or anything. I am just trying to show you how the functions actually work, right? So let's say I have function A and B. And let's say I have a function C. And I'm calling C from this particular point. So let's say this is my program, a very brief program, which is like I have a main function, which will be of course called in the first instance. And then I have a function, which is A. So the moment I call the function A, everything following this function will be temporarily suspended, right? So from A, main, it will come to A, execute everything in A, and go back to the point where A was called. Now where A was called in the function main. So it returns to main. Then we have something of called phi. We have a function B. So now B, it will see that, okay, B is defined here. It calls B here now. Now within B, I have a function C here. Now C will be called from this point and executed. When C finishes the execution, C basically goes, yes. No, I didn't hear you. B will be, can you repeat again? Yeah, I think there is too much noise. But then, Okay, I think it is better now. Yes, okay. Okay, so Man, you were asking something. You can please repeat. You have to unmute yourself, actually. I have muted everyone now. I think I am not able to hear you out. Achha, guys, I mean, how many of you could not configure VS Code or etc. can type in the chat window, right? I hope everyone has configured because, see, guys, coding is like ocean, you know. The moment you will do, you will understand. Not everything can be explained in the lecture, right? Lectures are more about syntax and all, so it is more about practice. And hence, I asked all of you to please configure your Dropbox because as and when I find new codes, I will just place them in Dropbox and you can just try to blindly execute. Right? Blindly execute means you just take the code, try to execute it, and see what happens. Right? So, if you see, I have a function here, basically function underscore 3. Here, I am actually computing the maximum between two values. Right? This we will see in the next lecture. But you can just come to the program, right click, run the code, and try to see what is the output here, and then try to reverse engineer. Right? I'm sharing on Dropbox because it will sync automatically. So it's not like I have to email you again and again and again. And in the Dropbox, I'm also keeping the reading material. So there are three books. It depends which you want to see. Books always help you to understand the more inbuilt concepts. And the slides for today's lectures are here. So I have not covered everything as of now, but you can just go through the slides. I will try to teach you more from a coding point of view so that you realize the concept. Any doubts, any issues, or questions are welcome. Or else we can exit for today and that's it. We meet on Tuesday then. Just ensure that VS Code and Dropbox are installed in your system. It will help you in future also. Dropbox helps, like between friends, if you are sharing assignments or notes or anything, it can help you seamlessly share those things. Yes. Oh, then okay, probably then you need to install an antivirus and then remove the virus first. So you can install anything of Avira. You can just WhatsApp me, I will try to help you out. Okay. Yeah, you can just WhatsApp me or the screenshot and then I will try to help you out. Okay, class, then I think we are already 1 o'clock. So thank you so much. And we will meet on Tuesday then. Just ensure that VS Code and Dropbox are synced. Okay, it will help you practice more easily and faster. Okay, guys, yes. Yes, you can use. I have no issues at all. But just because there are 395 students in the class, I wanted some uniformity. But there is absolutely no issue. You can use Eclipse, you can use JetBrains IDE, you can use Sublime, you can even configure Notepad++. But just ensure that you don't use Turbo C, right? Ensure that the compiler is GCC so that there is at least some uniformity in the code, right? You can use Sublime, no issues. Okay, class. Yes. The others can leave, right? Those who have some issues, you can ask. Others can leave. Yeah. Yeah, you need to download Dropbox or else the folder will not sync and then you may not be able to get the codes. If you have an issue with their slow system or anything else, you can ask your friend to send them. Because if you see lecture by lecture, now the lecture folders are empty, but over time I will keep on adding lectures in these folders, right? So you can directly run this code on your system for practice purposes. It will help you in the near future. So class, please try to execute the codes once again on your system. Try to add a function on your own. Try to write a function. Just plug and play around, and you will learn functions very easily. Any queries, or we can end the meeting, guys? Okay. So I'm closing the meeting. Goodbye.